Welcome to MHM Podcast Network on MovieHouseMemories.com. Podcast for pod people. Our feature presentation begins now.
Welcome to Sunday Seconds with the Duke on the MHM Podcast Network, our monthly white hat reviews of films dedicated to the stuff men are made of, John Wayne. I am Chris.
I'm Lori.
I'm Patrick.
In this episode, we are going to have some French Polynesian fun with our review of the 1963 comedy, Donovan's Reef. Directed by John Ford and starring John Wayne, Lee Marvin, Jack Warden, and Elizabeth Allen. And who has the summary for this one?
I do. Donovan's Reef begins with the Navy veteran, Boats Gilhooley, jumping ship as it passes his adopted home of How is it pronounced?
That's close enough. What the hell in the French Polynesian Islands.
All right. Haleakaloha in the French Polynesian Islands during the Christmas season. The waterlogged Santa Claus is seeking to give a gift in the form of a roundhouse punch to his best friend from the Navy, Michael Guns Donovan. Guns also lives on the small island and is returning from a fishing trip where he is met by their mutual expatriate friend, William Doc Dedham. The three men had set up shop on the island after the war. Doc is the only physician on the island and takes care of the natives' medical needs while raising his three children that he fathered with the island's former princess. The children's mother died during childbirth years before, and Doc has been raising them with the help of Guns and the other islanders. Gilhooley arrives on the island on his birthday, which he also shares with Guns. The two men have a tradition going back over two decades where they have a knockdown, drag-out fight on that day to celebrate their birth. The fight is broken up by Doc, who points out the ridiculousness of the fight and asks what the two men have been fighting about over the decades, to which neither man has a clear answer. After the big fight, the two men make nice with each other, and we learn that Doc is about to leave for a few weeks to take care of some of the islands on the outskirts of the Polynesian Islands. As it so happens, the Doc's estranged daughter, Amelia Dedham, arrives right after he leaves. Amelia is on the island to get evidence that Doc Dedham is living an immoral life, which would break an outdated but still enforced morality clause that will keep him from collecting on his stock inheritance. The inheritance would give Doc majority control of the family's business, which Amelia wants to prevent. When Guns finds out about Amelia's arrival, he, Gilhooley, and Haleakaloha's French governor, the suave Marquis de Loge, come up with a plan to pass off Doc's Hoppe children as Guns. The oldest child, Leilani, is devastated about having to live out the deception and would love to meet and acknowledge her older half-sister. However, Guns and de Loge convince her to go along with the plan. Along the way, Amelia falls in love with Guns and the kids. Once Doc Dedham does return from his trip, Amelia learns the truth that not only are the children his, but that he is a great man that has helped the people of the island for years. Far from finding the immoral man she thought her father was, Amelia finds a caring man that she is proud to call Dad. The film ends with the biggest happy ending ever. Amelia gets her father back, three new siblings, a husband, and all the stock she needs for control of her family's business. Gilhooley marries his longtime girlfriend and becomes the owner of the bar, Donovan's Reef. All seems right in the world until next Christmas when Gilhooley and Guns will duke it out to the delight of the locals. And that's Donovan's Reef.
Donovan's Reef was released on June 12, 1963, the same day as Cleopatra. And I'm sure, Lori, you saw that the same day too. Both of them back to back.
Double feature.
Yeah. This had a budget of $2.6 million and made $6.6 million. For comparison, Cleopatra made $57 million. So not as successful. Rotten Tomatoes gives it a 60% critics, 77% audience. There were no Academy Award nominations for it that year, but then...
Not possible.
I know, it's a shocker. But then it did go up against Lawrence of Arabia and To Kill a Mockingbird. They might be a little bit better in this one.
A little bit.
This was the final John Wayne, John Ford collaboration. And this was one of the last few films that John Ford actually completed. The final two being 1964's Cheyenne Autumn and 1966's Seven Women. Does it show it? Does it seem like he's on the downside of his career, Patrick?
Oh, yeah. It's definitely in the downside. I mean, when you're being miscast to play the love interest to a woman who's 20 years younger than you and just making it look like it's nothing, not even addressing that issue. He was doing this so he could go to Hawaii with his friends and make a movie. That was it.
I would do it to go to Hawaii with my friends.
I would too. But.
Well, that's pretty much how he pitched it to Lee Marvin. His pitch to Lee Marvin was, do you want your kids to be brown as berries? Don't you want to spend 8 weeks in Hawaii this summer? Then do the picture. And Lee Marvin didn't even see the script. He just said yes.
I don't think he ever saw the script.
I would agree.
Do you think these people were actually drunk when they filmed this, by the way?
I don't think John Wayne was. I think Lee Marvin was a lot.
I agree. He just didn't seem to be there.
He was pretty silly.
Yeah, he was almost a caricature. I mean, his character was so over the top. And actually, I thought Dorothy L'Amour was too.
Is that his girlfriend?
Yeah. I really like
Ford's girlfriend or. Lee Marvin, the character's girlfriend.
Well, Lee Marvin and
Gilhooley. Was that his name? Gilhooley?
Yeah. And is she supposed to be a bad singer?
I think she's the only thing that the island has. So it doesn't really matter. It's drunk sailors and her. It's kind of like the Old West where it's pretty much that's all you get.
Yeah. She's a horrible singer.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't say she's horrible. She's horrible. Not good, but I wouldn't say she's horrible.
She's horrible.
I think she's sung better than that. That's what I don't get. Wasn't she like in all the road movies with Bing Crosby and Bob Hope? And
I know she's in a couple, but I remember them singing. I don't remember her singing.
No. Well, she sang the Marlene Dietrich version of Silent Night, which is just in a strange key.
That's
the key of terrible, by the way. And especially when you compare it to the songs from the natives, I don't know if they were actually singing or just a recording of some other people singing the songs. But when you compare it to the native type songs, she does not hold up at all.
That's true.
So, Patrick, you mentioned it that Elizabeth Allen was 20 years younger than John Wayne. But other than that, I thought it was a reasonably realistic relationship between the two. I think they had pretty good chemistry otherwise. Much better than like a James Bond type 20-year gap.
Well, yeah, that's true. She plays older than she actually was. She plays so uptight that I think she looks more maternal, much older, and older than she was in real life. And plus, this is like 60s era, so she doesn't have that youthful vigor to her that you see in a lot of very young actresses in the age. So
especially in that lawyer's office, very frumpy. Yeah.
That was so awkward. I felt like I was watching a kid's movie.
I think of Donovan's Reef almost as a kid's movie, even though it deals with a lot with alcoholism and fighting and.
But I mean, it had
racism and
that. Scene had the acting was so over the top. I felt like I was watching Power Rangers or something with my son. It was so bad.
It was like poor slapstick comedy is what it was. Like they kind of forced it on you. And the funnier stuff was the more subtle.
Exactly. It was so awkward. And the way she was acting in those glasses and the pictures. I mean, it could have been funny, all the pictures of Jack Warden. But it wasn't because of the music, and it was just so, I don't know, that scene was, that was just really awkward.
I feel like Don Knotts would have fit in very well in this film.
Exactly. Yes. It was like Apple Dumpling Gang or something.
Yeah. Early 70s Disney live action film.
Exactly. Although Apple Dumpling Gang is funny, but it wasn't funny, but it kind of had that feel to it. Exactly. That's exactly what it felt like. But I disagree. I didn't feel they had chemistry.
No?
I didn't have a problem with the age. It wasn't even that. It's just I didn't feel like the relationship really developed. I don't know. It was kind of like you're watching it and there's tension and then all of a sudden, bam. I don't know. I just, it just didn't work for me.
And I'll agree. I don't think there's really any chemistry. I also don't think it's really that important to the storyline to have a romantic interest for Donovan, other than it's John Wayne and you got to give him something to do. That the fact that she develops a relationship, a respect for, and an understanding of her father is mm-hmm. what this film is ultimately, what is the core of this film is what it's about. And I wish they would have focused on that and not spent so much time on Donovan and his relationship with her. Because it wasn't, at the end of the day, I didn't think that was important. If she developed a relationship with her father, she can stay for that reason and to know her father better. And
her siblings.
And her siblings, true.
And the preconceived notion for both of them was very stereotypical, just based on what the other person thought they would be. It wasn't much her dad's point of view because he didn't know she was coming. But for the others around there, they thought she was going to be this uptight person who wouldn't accept him. And she was going there thinking he was some bum living in a shack who just abandoned her and her mom. And you see towards the end that they're both people of character and quality and they have the same values and they're both good people, I think.
Yeah, I mean, that's the MacGuffin of this film is how is she going to react to her siblings? And, you know, and she suspects something throughout most of the film and then gets the confirmation and never blinks an eye, you know, which is one of the things that works about this film and at least is admirable about this film is that you don't have to see a growth in this character. It doesn't bother her from the get-go to know anything about it, or at least they don't show it bothering her from, you know, she just finds out the information and gladly accepts it and it seems to be kind of a joy to have, you know, two more sisters and a brother.
And they're adorable.
Very 60s precocious, I thought.
Oh, I really, the older girl, what was her name? Leilani? Was that her name?
The princess.
She was amazing. Her acting, I felt, you know, like you could see the hurt when she had to, you know, deny who she was. And I looked her up because I thought, why didn't she go on to do bigger things? Because I thought she was so talented. But I guess she retired from acting really young and was a school teacher in California.
Was she a white person that they darkened her skin with makeup like Cesar Romero or?
You know what? I think she had a Polynesian name. Let me look. I can't remember. I looked her up the other day. Let me see.
Because like Cesar Romero, his skin tone and he just seemed out of place.
Like she was born in L.A. So.
Oh. Okay. Well, she is Polynesian then.
So I'm not sure. Jacqueline Malouf was her name. M-A-L-O-U-F.
She sounds French. So what did you think of Cesar Romero in this one, kind of the Lando Calrissian of the film?
Slimy.
Yeah, he was. Those French, can't trust them.
I don't think he had anything to do with him being French. I think he, who did he play in Batman? Was he the...
It's a Joker.
The Joker.
See? Slimy.
That's why I always think of Cesar Romero as the Joker. And when I see him in something else, it's hard for me to think of him as in anything else that even though this is probably predates his play portrayal of the Joker that I always think of him as that and, you know, and the kind of the over the top nature of it, but he didn't bother me. He's there for comic relief. You know, it's, they didn't seem to commit to him doing anything like, oh, he's going to try to, you know, compete for her affections with John Wayne and, not really. Just like, I'm going to try to put this other girl in John Wayne's bed. Oh, he threw her out the window. Oh, well.
That whole scene was just bizarre to me.
C'est la vie, I guess they say in French.
Yeah, that was.
Is c'est la vie a French for toss her out the window? Is that what it?
Yeah.
I'm glad that she saw through him, because if she didn't, I wouldn't have had any respect for her character.
I think she saw through him at the get-go.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm glad. I was worried.
I'm used to seeing Jack Warden as playing an older guy. I mean, he was still fairly old in this one, but like I mean, the really white-haired older guy is what I'm pretty.
Do you know what? He was only like 10 years older than her. He wasn't old enough to be her father, but he looked a lot older than her.
Say, was that guy ever young? Is the question.
He could be like Abe Vigoda, where he just always looked old, but he did look young to me in this film. Younger, I guess.
He looked younger.
I mean, he's still handsome. He just looks older.
It just, when I saw his name in the credits, I was like, oh, Jack, I'd forgotten Jack Warden was in it. And then I saw him on the scene. I'm like, in a scene. And I'm like, how old is Jack Warden when he died? Like 100, you know,
you think it's just that he grayed prematurely because he had gray hair.
Yeah. It's gotta be somewhat like Martin or something.
Yeah.
I'm looking to see how old he was.
Because his face.
He was 85 when he died in 2006. So.
Oh, I thought you were saying he was 85.
No.
But he was really good in this. I felt that the supporting characters kind of stole, all of them, but I felt the Leilani, I felt the kid, the children, and I even thought after the first scene, Elizabeth Allen did a good job. Towards the end of the movie, she was better. I didn't like her at the beginning of the movie. I didn't like the way she acted, but I felt the children and Jack Warden kind of stole the show. I thought that, like, as Patrick said, that relationship was really interesting to watch. That scene where he explains to her what happened. And
I would have liked to see the whole movie with just them two, for sure.
I agree. That was a really interesting story.
And by the way, he was 42 when they filmed this.
That's young.
Mm-hmm. He looks much to older you. Than 40. Now, this was set on the fictional island of, I'm going to butcher this name, how do you say it? Haleakaloha, holy, what it? Haleakaloha?
That's it.
Hola.
But it was filmed in Hawaii because they wanted a Hawaiian vacation. But what I found interesting when I was reading online was that, you know, the French Polynesian islands are way south of Hawaii and southeast of Japan. And so there was never an actual battle in this area of the world that they supposedly fought valiantly for and saved the locals from. So that was a pretty interesting little side note. And it kind of showed that John Ford didn't care.
I think the script kind of shows that John Ford didn't care.
Yeah, I get it. You know, you say this is the last one of the John Ford, John Wayne films, their collaboration. And, you know, the trend that they're in at this point in time is I'd hate to have seen one more, because as much as I do like Donovan's Reef more for sentimental reasons, that I find it entertaining. I like to see John Wayne doing a little comedy and doing something different. It is not a good film. So, you know,
I didn't hate it.
No, I don't. But,
yeah.
Yeah, I don't hate it, but your description of it reminded me of a Disney movie is probably the best description I can think of how I think of this film, is that I look at it as like the Cat from Outer Space and the North Avenue Irregulars and, you know, Flubber. that kind of over the top acting, you know, from that they didn't spend a lot of money on getting great actors for those roles. And this was just, you know, a group of people getting together to have some fun in Hawaii and make a movie at the same time. And I'm sure it didn't cost a lot and it didn't, you know, didn't make a lot. So
a nice little vanity project.
Correct. Yeah.
John Wayne just driving the Jeep, how it would jerk when he started it and how it threw Amelia off the back and she just landed square in her butt, all for terrible comedic effect. I guess that was pretty much what I think of a lot of bad comedies in the 60s, that sort of style. So I guess it fits in that regard. But they did try too hard, because the things that made me laugh was the subtle humor aspects of this film, not any of that stuff that's pushed on us.
And Dorothy L'Amour kind of reminded me of Norma Desmond, just the look on her face. There was one point where I felt like I was watching Sunset Boulevard.
Yeah, that's a good analogy.
She did. It was. I'm just like, that's not Dorothy L'Amour. What is going on? So I think she was trying to be this wacky character, and it just didn't work. Well, the setting was beautiful, though. The Kauai is beautiful. I've never been to Hawaii, but my in-laws believe Kauai is the most beautiful island. And I wish they had shown more of the scenery. I felt like, you know what I mean? I felt like they could have done more panning shots and stuff than they did. They didn't use the gorgeous paradise that they had as much as they could have, I think.
That one scene, I thought they were in the Grand Canyon.
Oh, when they got the Christmas tree?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
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 It looked more like they're filming on location in Arizona than...
It was beautiful. I think there are areas of Kauai that are like that. It's the Garden Island too, and I thought, why didn't they show more of that?
Does that mean that Kauai is Hawaiian for Jersey, the Garden Island?
That was a good one.
That was a long stretch.
It was a good one. I liked it.
And one of the things that I thought really was bizarre is when she arrived at the island on the boat, I'm like, how are they getting her on the island? Don't they have just like a little boat to lower her into the water instead of trying to get this woman who's dressed all proper into this little canoe? And I'm like, of course she's going in the water. There's just no way.
Yeah. And the way the movie was going, you knew she was going in the water.
Mm-hmm. I knew as soon as she was on the screen that she was going into the water, but
there was a lot of people in water in this film. Water everywhere, I noticed. It rained.
And it didn't look cold.
No. Well, this also reminds me of another scene where she spends the night at the first night she's there. She spends the night and it's blowing wind everywhere, wind and rain. And it looks like it's a little mini hurricane or whatever. And then the next day you see an outdoor scene and everything is nicely manicured. Everything is up and proper as if there was no big storm the night before, blowing everything everywhere.
Well, there was a lot of Polynesians around to clean up the yard. So that was
ordered around by an angry little Chinese guy.
Right.
I really, what I thought was the funniest scene was when they were in the Christmas service and it started to rain and just all at once nonchalantly everyone opened their umbrella. I thought that was kind of cute.
Well, that was a scene that had a lot of subtle humor, like when Cesar Romero stood up to take over, John Wayne sat in his seat and you know the Cesar Romero kind of glared at him. There it was a lot of little posturing and a lot of you know subtle things back and forth, and I liked that part much more than like the hitting with the stick on the guy in the boat and anything, the awkward fight scenes and all that. I thought that was the best part of the film, that kind of humor.
I agree.
I like the fight scene with the British Navy towards the end of the film. I thought that was
it was a free for all. It was like the British guys are even hitting the British guys.
Okay. What does limey mean?
It's kind of a slang for British people back in the day when you had to worry about scurvy. They would they would eat lemons and then later limes to get their necessary vitamin C, and it kind of evolved from that, calling them limeys. And so it's seen as derogatory.
Okay. Patrick had me use it and I didn't even know what it meant. In that summary, remember?
I thought he was going to leave it with, it refers to British people.
That would have been great. I should have thought of that.
So it's like them calling us Yankee?
Yeah. Maybe a little bit more. I guess it depends on the context of how they're saying it, but yeah.
Well, they meant Yankee derogatory, and then we took it with pride, so.
Yeah.
Well, I don't anymore, not for the New York Yankees. So. No pride there.
He'd rather be called a Steeler.
Oh.
Maybe not. Well, you know, Lori, that brings us to our next section, since you're asking about limeys. Wayne controversies. So John Wayne films have been known to have controversies, and I don't know if this is, if it's necessarily controversies, but they definitely address the subject of racism in this film. It wasn't just a little happy-go-lucky throwaway comedy all the time. I guess there was a subtext. You know, there was racism. The overall theme was how people would deal with the Polynesian people of darker skin. You know, this very proper girl from Boston. There was Chinese racism towards the Chinaman, and who was the servant. The Chinaman?
The Chinky.
The Chinky. He even had his own sort of racism toward the Polynesians. It was like this little hierarchy. And then as Lori just mentioned, there's this kind of American-French racism towards the British sailors, calling them limeys, even though they're on the same side of the battle. So I think that was a very good aspect of this film that I wish they would have strengthened, because it was an anti-racism movie, I think, just not done well.
Well, it ends as an anti-racism movie, but it seemed that the characters throughout the entire film acknowledge the racism and let's hide the kids because we don't want her to know about them, because she will judge him as morally inferior because he had a sexual relationship, a romantic relationship, a marriage possibly to an island girl. And island princess girl, obviously. But that they didn't sit there and say, well, let's show that how good these kids are. And I mean, because once you, as you go through the course of the story, that she's not just like the local stripper girl that he got attracted to and knocked up and then had three kids with. I mean, there's a history there, and a very distinguished history. And they don't seem to think that that's good enough, that they try to go along and just say, this is what just needs to be done to cover it up. That seems ridiculous. It's only saved at the end by Amelia just acknowledging, these are my siblings and I'm proud of them, you know, and I'm happy to know them. And they make my life more complete at the same time as she learns more about her father and that who her father is.
And it's interesting too, because they didn't even know about the company and her coming to look for some moral failing in him for the claws, right? When they hatched that plan.
Yeah.
He so that, personally that was, might have known it just because he was around back in the day, but the John Wayne and the Cesar Romero characters did not, for sure.
And that made him more endearing to me, hearing his story and him saying, I don't care about the company. I really wish that those characters had been developed more, because that was an interesting storyline.
I could have seen her staying there too. I guess it's implied, but I could have seen her staying there just without the John Wayne character and her staying with her dad to help these people.
Absolutely. Well, she fell in love with those kids. I mean, before I think she even knew they were her siblings. And as Patrick said, they didn't need that romance, and I felt it was a distraction, and it didn't really work. I don't think they really developed that relationship.
Well, Lori, we talked about the racism. What about the sexism? Look how this film ends. He's bending her over to spank her ass.
That was annoying.
What was the reason for that, by the way? Just he's now the husband and has to put her in her place?
When you're romancing a child like that, you know, sometimes you got to be, you know.
They had that weird relationship, Pax. You know, I mean, they were just constantly at each other and coming to.
You know, why did they call it Pax? They should just said peace. I'm like, who talks like that, even in the 60s?
I mean, I don't know. That didn't bother me. That was like their code word. But there, it just was an awkward relationship. And I don't think it had anything to do with the age difference. And even though I didn't feel like John Wayne, I mean, when they kissed and stuff, it was so wooden by John Wayne. But I don't even think it was it was that. I just think it just never developed in the script. And it just didn't work. And so that ending was weird. I don't know. I feel like he, you know, he was kind of kidding with her and saying, I'm wearing the pants in the family now and, you know, spanking her. I felt like it was all in good natured fun. I didn't feel like, you know, but
Island S&M, that's just not right, Lori.
It just didn't work. It just didn't work.
My feeling was they were trying to show them as intellectual equals, where she thought that he was inferior because he's a saloon owner. And then, you know, slowly revealed that he owned all the shipping and he had the same profession as she does. And so I think, and that's kind of why they said Pax, just because it's a Latin word that people might know and it might show that they're at least formally educated. And I don't know, that's my only thought, but that there's no proof behind that. It's just a theory that I would have.
I think a lot more people used to know Latin. I think it was more common to be taught in schools and stuff.
Well, especially if you're a Catholic, they didn't do the services in English for a while,
right,
did they?
Right, yeah.
Patrick, since you did the summary, I'll give you the first word on this one. On a scale of 1 to 5 white hats, how many would you give it? And any last thoughts on it?
I'd give it 3 hats. It's an enjoyable little film. It's not the greatest John Wayne film. It's not the worst John Wayne film by any stretch of the imagination. It has many flaws, but I can overlook it because at least it's some variety. It's not a Western. It's not a war film. It's a comedy, which he doesn't do a lot of. He does some, but it, you know, it's John Ford. The scenery is beautiful. I like the supporting cast, although I would agree that Lee Marvin is kind of phoning it in. And I would have liked to have seen him do more in the film because I like Lee Marvin. And I kind of like the camaraderie that he has with John Wayne as well as Jack Warden in the kind of the backstory that these three guys who went through hell together, literally, and now have just decided to retire and live in this island paradise. I think that's kind of an interesting subplot that didn't get developed as much as it should have, but it's a decent film. It's I'm sure Lori didn't like it as much as some of the other films that we started off this podcast with, for the first few films, because we were picking a lot of the greater films, but this is a lesser film and it definitely shows.
I'll go with 3 hats as well. It is not the, I agree, it's not the caliber of film, as Patrick said, but it's not a horrible film. There's a lot of charming things about it. I mean, I would watch it again if it was on. There's definitely things I liked about it. I kind of think it's a film that's ripe for remaking and developing those characters. And couldn't you see, like, George Clooney and some of his gang remaking this? And
modern era, you don't see too many island paradises in Afghanistan. But
why do you have to make it in Afghanistan?
It could be in Dubai.
They could still set it. They could still set it after World War II.
They could, but then now you're putting it into it a different era that I don't know if it translates. And why would you do it if you're not updating it in some way?
Because you would update it by developing those characters. There's a great story to be told there, as you said. I would love to see more of the relationship between those three. Those Navy buddies, and I'd love to see more of the relationship of the siblings develop and some resolution with the racism and some more, you know, not just kind of glossing over it. There's so much that can be done with that story. I think it could really be a phenomenal film.
I don't think so.
I do.
Now I'll agree with both of you. I think 3 white hats is a good measurement for this film. I thought it was a very charming film. I liked it a lot. I liked the music in this film, not the singing, but not the character singing, but the native singing, the C&H Pure Cane Sugar song stuck out. And it was a really charming, beautiful movie to watch. I liked the scenery. I kind of liked the fights, I guess. And I did, unlike you two, I did like the chemistry between John Wayne and Elizabeth Allen. Or maybe I just liked Elizabeth Allen. I'm not exactly sure which way. When I liked her chemistry with the kids, for sure, especially with the little boy, that one worked for me. So, yeah, it's just an average film. I've seen better 60s comedies, though. It is time to mosey off into the sunset, but you don't have to stop listening. You can get more of our blockbuster reviews at mhmpodcastnetwork.com, where we have many more reviews from our sister shows at Movie House Memories, Lunchtime Movie Review, The Number 2 Review, and Male Bonding. Until next time, I am Chris.
And I'm Lori.
And I'm Patrick.
Thanks once again for listening. And remember, there's more to being a tropical cowboy than just wearing the flip-flops. See, I changed it up, Lori.
This podcast is not endorsed by Paramount Home Video and is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Donovan's Reef, all names and sounds of Donovan's Reef characters, and any other Donovan's Reef related items are registered trademarks and or copyrights of Paramount Home Video or their respective trademark and or copyright holders. All original content of this podcast is the intellectual property of Sunday Seconds with the Duke, the MHM Podcast Network, and Fuzzy Bunny Slippers Entertainment, LLC, unless otherwise noted.